It happened again. I was actually planning on showing you guys finals weeks at my university, but since it's pretty much just been me in dark rooms the entire week, I figured why not do something fun again? So this time, I think we should talk about the digital revolution. Hope you guys enjoy. It's probably gonna be like, it's gonna be longer this time. I think it's gonna be like 20 minutes. Let's go for it.
The technology likely to have the greatest impact on the next few decades has arrived. And it's not social media, it's not big data, it's not robotics, it's not even AI. And you'll be surprised to learn that it's the underlying technology of digital currencies like Bitcoin. It's called the blockchain.
Economists have been exploring how we exchange value. They've studied the institutions that facilitate our trade, like legal systems, corporations, marketplaces. But there is a new technological institution that will fundamentally change how we exchange value. And it's called the blockchain.
I believe that this is now the next generation of the internet, and that it holds vast promise for every business, every society, and for all of you individually. For the past few decades, we've had the internet of information. When I send you an email or a PowerPoint file or something, I'm actually not sending you the original, I'm sending you a copy. And that's great. This is democratized information. But when it comes to assets, things like money, financial assets like stocks and bonds, loyalty points, intellectual property, music, art, a vote, carbon credit, and other assets, sending you a copy is a really bad idea. If I send you $100, it's really important that I don't still have money and that I can't send it to you. So this has been called the double spend problem by cryptographers for a long time. Today, we rely entirely on big intermediaries, middlemen like banks, government, big social media companies, credit card companies, and so on, to establish trust in our economy. And these intermediaries perform all the business and transaction logic of every kind of commerce. And overall, they do a pretty good job, but there are growing problems. To begin, they're centralized. That means that they can be hacked, and increasingly are. And JP Morgan, US federal government, LinkedIn, Home Depot, and others found that out the hard way. They exclude billions of people from the global economy. For example, people who don't have enough money to have a bank account. They slow things down. It can take a second for an email to go around the world, but it can take days or weeks for money to move through the banking system across the city. And they take a big piece of the action, 10 to 20% just to send money to another country.
Bitcoin is better than currency because it shows how cheap it can be. You don't have to be physically in the same place. And of course, for large transactions, currency can get pretty inconvenient. The Bitcoin technology is key, and you could add to it or you could build a similar technology where there's enough attribution that people feel comfortable.
What are these and how do they fit in the Bitcoin universe?
So if you really boil down what we do to very simplistic form, we just build software that makes it easy for consumers and for businesses to interact with the core Bitcoin protocol. So the core Bitcoin protocol is very unwieldy. It's large, it's difficult to interact with. What we do is we build open source software that makes dealing with that protocol very friendly.
Okay, so is this kind of like an account? It's like having a bank account? You get
it's
a
not like
Bitcoin
a bank account.
Account.
So a bank takes your money and they hold it for you mm-hmm. on your behalf. Mm-hmm. They do transactions for you, they receive money for you. We don't do that. What we do is provide a software solution that enables you to manage your own funds.
If I want to go and buy some Bitcoin right now, would I go to your site or would I go to a Bitcoin exchange? Walk me through that process and where you guys fit in along the way.
So we're a pure software provider and we're providing a lot of the software that powers some of those end applications, mm-hmm. but we don't currently offer any kind of exchange services. So we purely deal in software that enables the Bitcoin economy and enables Bitcoin transactions peer-to-peer.
So what does Buffett not like right now? That would be Bitcoin. He says that Bitcoin right now looks a little bit tulip-like to him.
It's not a currency. I mean, it does not meet the test of a currency. I wouldn't be surprised if it's not around in 10 or 20 years.
Why does it not meet the definition of a currency?
Well, because people say, well, I'll sell you goods in Bitcoins, but they change the price of those every time the price of the dollar changes in relation to the Bitcoin. They're pricing off the dollar. They could say, well, I'll sell it to you in barrels of oil, But if they every time the price of oil changes, they change the number of barrels you have to have. That's not your oil is not the currency.
Now, my opinion of Bitcoin is that I think Bitcoin is probably a good thing. I think it's primarily going to be a means of doing illegal transactions. But that's not necessarily entirely bad, because some things shouldn't be illegal. But it will be useful for legal and illegal transactions. Otherwise, it would have no value as a use of for legal transactions, because you have to have a legal to illegal bridge.
Yeah.
I don't own any Bitcoin.
Do you think this is a currency that's really going to work eventually?
Well, I think it is working, there will be other currencies like it that may be even better. But in the meantime, there's a big industry around Bitcoin. Mm-hmm. People have made fortunes out of Bitcoin. Some people have lost money out of Bitcoin. It is quite volatile, but in volatility, people can make money out of volatile situations.
Why was it important for you to give it sort of that stamp of approval, that endorsement, by saying to the Winklevoss twins, yes, you can pay for the ride with Bitcoin?
Because I'm not foolish. I mean, if people have got lots of Bitcoins and they want to go to space, I'd much rather they spent that money on our spaceship. Whether I keep 50 Bitcoins is another matter.
And the biggest problem is that overall, we have wealth creation, but we have growing social inequality. So what if there were not only an internet of information, what if there were an internet of value? Some kind of vast, global, distributed ledger running on millions of computers and available to everybody, and where every kind of asset, from money to music, could be stored, moved, transacted, exchanged, and managed, all without powerful intermediaries. What if there were a native medium for value? Well, in 2008, the financial industry crashed, and perhaps propitiously, a unknown or anonymous person or persons named Satoshi Nakamoto created a paper where he developed a protocol for a digital cash that used an underlying cryptocurrency called Bitcoin. And this cryptocurrency enabled people to establish trust and do transactions without a third party. And the seemingly simple act set off a spark that's ignited the world, that has everyone excited or terrified or otherwise interested in many places. Now, don't be confused about Bitcoin, okay? Bitcoin is an asset. It goes up and down, and that should be of interest to you if you're a speculator. More broadly, it's a cryptocurrency. It's not a fiat currency controlled by a nation state, and that's of greater interest. But the real pony here is the underlying technology. It's called blockchain. So, for the first time now in human history, people everywhere can trust each other and transact peer-to-peer. And trust is established not by some big institution, but by collaboration, by cryptography, and by some clever code. And because trust is native to the technology, I call this the trust protocol. Now, you're probably wondering, well, how does this thing work? Digital assets like money to music and everything in between are not stored in a central place, but they're distributed across a global ledger using the highest level of cryptography. And when a transaction is conducted, it's posted globally across millions and millions of computers. And out there around the world is a group of people called miners. These are not young people, they're Bitcoin miners. And they have massive computing power at their fingertips, 10 to 100 times bigger than all of Google worldwide. And these miners do a lot of work. And every 10 minutes, kind of like the heartbeat of a network, a block gets created that has all the transactions from the previous 10 minutes. And then the miners get to work trying to solve some tough problems. And they compete. And the first miner to find out the truth and to validate the block is rewarded in digital currency, in the case of the Bitcoin blockchain, with Bitcoin. And then, this is the key part, that block is linked to the previous block and the previous block to create a chain of blocks, and everyone is timestamped, kind of like with a digital wax seal. So if I wanted to go and hack a block and say, pay you and you with the same money, I'd have to hack that block plus all the preceding blocks, the entire history of commerce on that blockchain, not just on one computer, but across millions of computers simultaneously, all using the highest levels of encryption in the light of the most powerful computing resource in the world that's watching me. Tough to do. And this is infinitely more secure than the computer systems that we have today. Blockchain, that's how it works. So the Bitcoin blockchain is just one. There are many. The Ethereum blockchain was developed by a Canadian named Vitalik Buterin. He's 19 years old. And this blockchain has some extraordinary capabilities. One of them is that you can build smart contracts. It's kind of what it sounds like. It's a contract that self-executes. And the contract handles the enforcement and the management, performance, and payment of agreements between people. And today, on the Ethereum blockchain, there are projects underway to do everything from create a new replacement for the stock market to create a new model of democracy where politicians are accountable to citizens. So to understand what a radical change this is going to bring, let's look at one industry, financial services. Recognize this? Rube Goldberg machine. It's a ridiculously complicated machine that does something really simple like crack an egg or shut a door. Kind of reminds me of the financial services industry, honestly. I mean, you tap your card in the corner store and a bitstream goes through a dozen companies, each with their own computer system, some of them being 1970s mainframes, and 3 days later, a settlement occurs. Well, with a blockchain financial industry, there would be no settlement because the payment and the settlement is the same activity. It's just a change in the ledger. So Wall Street and all around the world, the financial industry is in a big upheaval about this, wondering, can we be replaced or how do we embrace this technology for success? Now, why should you care? The first era of the internet of information, brought us wealth but not shared prosperity because social inequality is growing. And this is at the heart of all of the anger and extremism and protectionism and xenophobia and worse that we're seeing growing in the world today. Could we develop some new approaches to this problem of inequality? Because the only approach today is to redistribute wealth, tax people and spread it around more. Could we pre-distribute wealth? Could we change the way that wealth gets created in the first place by democratizing wealth creation, engaging more people in the economy, and in ensuring that they got fair compensation? Let me describe 5 ways that this can be done. Number one, did you know that 70% of the people in the world who have land have a tenuous title to it? So you got a little farm in Honduras, some dictator comes to power. He says, I know you got a piece of paper that says you own your farm, but the government computer says my friend owned your farm. This happened on a mass scale in Honduras, and this problem exists everywhere. Hernando de Soto, the great Latin American economist, says this is the number one issue in the world in terms of economic mobility, more important than having a bank account. Because if you don't have a valid title to your land, you can't borrow against it, and you can't plan for the future. So today, companies are working with governments to put land titles on a blockchain. And once it's there, this is immutable. You can't hack it. This creates the conditions for prosperity for potentially billions of people. Secondly, a lot of writers talk about Uber and Airbnb and TaskRabbit and Lyft and so on as part of the sharing economy. This is a very powerful idea that peers can come together and create and share wealth. These companies are not really sharing. In fact, they're successful precisely because they don't share. They aggregate services together and they sell them. What if rather than Airbnb being a $25 billion corporation, there was a distributed application on a blockchain, we'll call it B-Airbnb, and it was essentially owned by all of the people who have a room to rent. When someone wants to rent a room, they go onto the blockchain database and sift through, help them find the right room, and then the blockchain helps with the contracting, it identifies the party, it handles the payments, just through digital payments are built into the system, and it even handles reputation, because if she rates a room as a 5-star room, that room is there, and it's rated, and it's immutable. Number three, the biggest flow of funds from the developed world to the developing world is not corporate investment, and it's not even foreign aid, it's remittances. This is the global diaspora, people who've left their ancestral lands and they're sending money back to their families at home. This is $600 billion a year, and it's growing, and these people are getting ripped off. Annalie Domingo is a housekeeper. She lives in Toronto, and every month she goes to the Western Union office to send her remittances to her mom in Manila. It costs her around 10%. The money takes 4 to 7 days to get there. Mom never knows when it's going to arrive. It takes 5 hours out of her week to do this. 6 months ago, Annalie Domingo used a blockchain application called Abra. And from her mobile device, she said $300 went directly to her mom's mobile device without going through an intermediary. And then her mom looked at her mobile device. It's kind of like an Uber interface. There's Abra tellers moving around. She clicks on a teller that's a 5-star teller. He's 7 minutes away. Guy shows up at the door, gives her a Filipino peso. She puts them in her wallet. The whole thing took minutes, and it cost her 2%. This is a big opportunity for prosperity. Number four, the most powerful asset of the digital age is data. Data is really a new asset class, maybe bigger than previous asset classes like land or even money. And all of you, we create this data. We create this asset. And we leave this trail of digital crumbs behind us as we go throughout life. And these crumbs are collected into a mirror image of you, the virtual you. And the virtual you is not owned by you. That's the big problem. So today, there are companies working to create an identity in a black box, the virtual you owned by you. And this is a wonderful thing, because it can also help us protect our privacy. And privacy is the foundation of a free society. Let's get this asset that we create back under our control, where we can own our own identity and manage it responsibly. Finally, number five, there are a whole number of creators of content who don't receive fair compensation, because the system for intellectual property is broken. It was broken by the first era of the internet. Take music. Musicians are left with crumbs at the end of the whole food chain. You know, if you were a songwriter 25 years ago, you wrote a hit song, it got 1 million singles, you could get royalties of around $45,000. Today you're a songwriter, you write a hit song, it gets 1 million streams, you don't get $45,000, you get $36. So Imogen Heap, the Grammy-winning singer-songwriter, is now putting music on a blockchain ecosystem. She calls it mycelium. And the music has a smart contract surrounding it. And the music protects her intellectual property rights. You want to listen to the song? It's free. Or maybe it's a few microcents flow into a digital account. You want to put the song in your movie? That's different. And the IP rights are all specified. You want to make a ringtone? That's different. She describes that the song becomes a business. It's out there on this platform, marketing itself, protecting the rights of the author, and because the song is a payment system, in a sense, a bank account, all the money flows back to the artist, and they control the industry rather than these powerful intermediaries. This is not just songwriters, it's any creator of content, like art, inventions, scientific discoveries, journalists. There are all kinds of people who don't get fair compensation, and with blockchains, they're going to be able to make it rain on the blockchain, and that's a wonderful thing. Now, technology doesn't create prosperity, of course. People do. It's giving us another opportunity to rewrite the economic power grid and the old order of things and to solve some of the world's most difficult problems, if we will it. Thank you.
Yeah, it's a lot, I know. This was actually just supposed to be this cute short video. One thing, it is actually not possible to run a stock market off of blockchain technology, because blockchain technology is limited to 8 transactions a second, which won't work in a global market with a lot of transactions. And in blockchain, the way it works is that each individual miner competes with all the other ones. So the first one to take a certain number of transactions from this pool of transactions and put them in a block and then run all the algorithms correctly, get to put that block on the chain. This leaves a hole for people to take advantage of it by not choosing the specific transactions and putting them into their blockchains, because that way they will know stuff about the stock exchange before it's really happened. So it's sort of like insider trading on a very short scale, about 10 minutes. That's the time frame between each block. And that cannot really function in a global system. There is, however, a competing technology called Hashgraph right now, which can do about 100,000 transactions a second, which is enough for a global market and could be used to create this stock market. So I'm definitely not saying that it's impossible. I'm just saying that a lot has happened since 2016 when the TED Talk actually took place. Yeah, just wanted to put that out there. And his entire argument about equality is amazing, in my opinion. I really think it could change the world and better so many people's lives. But yeah, let me know what you guys think in the comments down below. I will make a video every single week like I always have. These two last weeks have been really fun. I don't think I can keep up with making one of these each week, though. It is really fun, but it is also finals week, and there's a lot of stuff going on, but I'm hoping to do a regular vlog next week. Check in to find out. See you guys next week.